Our first reading this morning comes from Psalm 16. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the holy ones in the land, they are the noble, in whom all is my delight. Those who choose another god multiply their sorrows. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names upon my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore my heart is glad, and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure. For you do not give me to Sheol, or let your faithful one see the pit. You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Second reading is 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And from the Gospel, John 20, 19 through 31. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, His disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet come to believe." Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Before I turn to the sermon, I want to express my thanks to the choir and our director of music for wonderful music on Easter and all through Lent, to the deacons for hosting our soup suppers, and to Nicole for her poignant reflections on women in the Bible and her wonderful leadership of our Palm Sunday service, to all those who have served in all the various capacities. The mission committee has been working very, very hard to raise some funds for mission, to our lectors, our greeters, our ushers. It takes a community to be a family of faith and to honor Jesus Christ. And I am very, very pleased to be pastor of this community. And I am very, very pleased by your outstanding service. You have truly made Lent and Easter most memorable. Thank you to you all, especially worship. Would you like to serve communion next week as well? We've had several communions.
Whenever
called. Well, grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and His Son Jesus Christ our Lord. The upper room was locked. The door was bolted. It was secure. Because at that time, after what the disciples had experienced, that was what they most desired. They wanted to be secure, to know they would be okay, to have a moment's peace. It had become a clear, impenetrable environment. There was a complete lockdown. Affected through the disciples on the inside and the world on the outside. It had become an upper room hideout, as desperate a place as had been by any group of criminals who found themselves on the lam. And within that room, among those disciples, there was an emotional stew. The psychologists tell us that there are 8 basic emotions. They were all there in that room, those 8 basic emotions. They were there all right. They were boiling over. There was sorrow. Jesus had been taken from them and killed. There was acceptance. Acceptance because he's dead. And in their desperation, they realized they couldn't change that. There was disgust. Disgust as in their traumatized state, they could remember and still so vividly see the effects of Jesus' torture being replayed over and over and over again in their minds. There was anger. They were angry at those Jewish leaders. They were angry at Pilate. They were angry at Rome, that despicable power. And yes, truth be told, they were angry at themselves.
They were angry at their cowardice. There was surprise. Rumors had been floating even among some of them that Jesus Christ was resurrected. Could it be true? There was joy for those who had indeed seen the risen Lord couldn't possibly contain themselves as they tried to convince the others. There was anticipation. If it was true, if it was real, if there was indeed resurrection, would they be privileged to see him? But most of all, there was fear. Their senses were overwhelmed. They were terrified. The Jews would probably be coming after them next, especially because the body's missing, and they were desperately afraid. So they locked themselves in. They kept hushed tones. The doors were bolted, the curtains were drawn. They were on the down low, as they say. And suddenly, miraculously, Jesus, the resurrected Lord, is right there in their midst. Just like that. He comes, and into this cowering group of disciples, he comes and he declares the ninth emotion, most important of all. He says, peace, arene, shalom, peace be with you. Wow. Jesus, who is not constrained by any boundary, whether it is a locked door or a locked and broken heart. Jesus, who is beyond all boundaries, interjects peace into the sea of human emotions and turmoil. Peace be with you. And Jesus shows them his hands and his side. This is not just some kind of sentimental saccharine greeting. This is not a Hallmark moment. It is peace that's been paid for with a price. He is resurrected and real, and the peace that he declares to those disciples and to us is real. In this resurrection, real peace occurs. It is a peace you can count on. When the world all around you is adversarial and tumultuous and turmoil and upset abounds, in Jesus Christ, there is his peace. Peace be with you. And the Lord tells them their job now. He says, peace I give to you, and now you are to go and be sent out. And so he breathes on them Holy Spirit. We remember Genesis with God the Father breathing into the dust and creating life. Jesus breathes Holy Spirit into these disciples now, and there is new life, resurrected life, life marked with peace and joy, life marked with the direction of being sent out, resurrected life. And he focuses them on sharing the news that there is forgiveness of sin, and that sin can be received in his grace. And if his grace is rejected, there is the retaining of sin. We can accept peace in him or war against him. We can receive life in him, or we can receive the wages of sin, which is death. We can receive resurrection in him, or we can receive, instead of heaven, hell. And in this peace, in this mission they have been commissioned to share, this mission critical outward focus, in this Holy Spirit empowerment, in this compelling action of declaring grace in Jesus Christ and forgiveness or the retaining of sin, the ministry of the resurrected Lord gets underway. It's a new day, a new chapter. It is the time of resurrection and new life in Jesus Christ. But guess what? One guy's missing. Thomas. Where was Thomas? We don't know. Perhaps he couldn't stand being locked up with those other disciples. Ever been in a meeting like that? Get me out of here. If it was something juicy, I'm sure we would know. The disciples were pretty good tattletales. So it's likely that it was at least something acceptable, something laudable. One commentator suggests that he might have even been out looking for Jesus. Isn't that an interesting thought? I could see myself tracking down the rumor of the resurrection and visiting all those special places where Jesus was, looking for him. If it was Presbyterian, he'd be looking to call a meeting to investigate the resurrection. In any event, Thomas certainly hadn't taken to the bunker with some of the others. And so when he returns, the others tell him that he missed it. He missed Jesus. He missed it. Have you ever missed it? Have you ever felt left out? Have you ever been left behind? Have you ever shown up 5 minutes too late and the bus had already left for school? Were you ever the one, the only one that wasn't chosen? Well, then you know how Thomas felt. And Thomas says, in some snippiness, I think, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." Now, some people call that doubting. But it seems to me that he just wanted what happened to them to happen to him. And a week later, on Resurrection Day 2, that's what happens. Jesus comes to Thomas, shows him his wounds, and gives him peace. And Thomas exclaims, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus makes this a moment for eternity when he says in response to Thomas, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." That's us. One writer says the resurrection doesn't create faith. Rather, faith receives the resurrection. For me, the point that makes sense regarding Thomas is that when we are all off on some self-imposed solitude, when we are distracted, when we take some initiative that is not well placed, when we miss it, when we feel alone, when we feel left out, neglected, confused, hurting, when we are overwhelmed with emotion, sometimes we feel second class. And when these different feelings seem to overwhelm us and seem to impair our faith, we can trust the resurrected, victorious Lord with our lives. He leaves none of us behind. He accounts for every one of his sheep, no matter how lost they may get. No wall, no boundary, no barrier, no closed condition of heart, mind, or soul can keep him out. And so for 2,000 years, people have believed in Jesus without literally touching his hands and side. For 2,000 years, people like us have been blessed with faith that receives the resurrection. And in this faith, we have found peace, we have found purpose, we have found Holy Spirit empowerment, because Jesus, in some convincing way, finds us and says to us, peace be with you. Our blessed Jesus, he will never abandon us. He will always empower us. And in the Holy Spirit, Christ's peace in our hearts enables us to embrace our calling as a people sent into the world with the good news of forgiveness of sins in him, and the good news of peace in the resurrected Jesus Christ. Without